Hi, I'm Ross Greenwood.
And I'm Richard Wilkins.
And he's the show.
And he's the business.
Together, they're show business.
Coming up this week, from X-Men to Dora the Explorer, we look at why movie makers pick Australia to produce their blockbusters.
Plus, the name's Bond, James Bond.
Is it really?
Well, hypothetically. How integration with the Bond franchise can add double O's to your bottom line?
Well, see what I did there? That's a good line. Yeah, very. And what's so special about another JB? In this particular case, we're talking about the Jonas Brothers, of course.
Your favourite group.
Indeed. First up, let's look at how our film industry is faring here in Australia. Look, we've had some monster movies made here in the past. Pirates of the Caribbean, Aliens, and of course,
you
more recently...
Caribbean, do you? I always thought it was Caribbean. Pirates of the Caribbean, yeah. Well, they made Star Wars here back in the
day.
They
did. Really, yeah. Some amazing films, didn't they? Yeah. What about one of your favourites, Aquaman?
I love Aquaman.
Yeah, what about that bloke? Who's the...
Jason Momoa, I think.
He's your mate, isn't he?
Well, he's a good lad.
Real men wear pink. Isn't that right, Jason Michael?
When Aquaman was being filmed on the Village Roadshow lot on the Gold Coast, it ended and there was a bit of a gap in the scheduling for new movies coming through. In fact, it was a bit of a worry at that stage for the Australian film industry. The real worry was...
you've got to keep them coming, right?
You've got to keep them coming the whole time. Because up there, there's around, I think it's 1,500 people or so employed, you know, highly skilled people who can go elsewhere around the world to apply their trade. Mm. And one of the real issues was Dora the Explorer.
Dora. Another of your favourites.
That's right. So the reason for this is because Dora the Explorer was absolutely the key to making sure that Australia had enough movies coming in the pipeline. And so as a result, the Queensland government had to go all out to make certain that this cartoon character, Dora, was made in Australia.
Because the government, I don't really understand it. The government support of films. I mean, I remember the time when all the movies were going out of Hollywood.
Yep.
You know, there were filmmakers walking around saying, keep Hollywood at home. But British Columbia in Canada, you know, Vancouver was the place that they called it Hollywood North. Everyone was going there because the Canadian government or the British Columbian government was giving them a tax thing. How does
that
work?
Right. So, okay, so here in Australia, that's exactly what's happened here, which is the reason why so many big blockbusters are now filmed right here in Australia.
Is it federal or state?
It's both. And this is where really Dora the Explorer comes into it, because what happened was, after Aquaman, there was nothing coming. And Dora was threatening to walk and go away overseas. Right? Yes, we can.
Dora was going to walk.
Dora was walking. She was going to explore.
Very good.
That's right. Other adventures. Anyway, so what happened was, as a result, there's a thing called the Australian Local Offset Tax Rebate.
Gee.
So that's a big mouthful. But what it means is if you spend money here in Australia in the movie industry or making television productions, the government gives you back a 16.5% basically tax offset.
Right. So if you spend, let's think of a big budget movie, $100 million.
Yep.
That's what Aquaman would have cost, probably. Nicole Kidman, they were...
Yep.
You know. So you get what back?
$16.5 million back out of that.
So if you spend $100 on production
they
costs,
give you $16.5 million back as a tax offset.
What, cash?
Pretty much so, when you put in your bills. Plus there's also the employment and so forth. Problem is, it's nowhere near enough. Because if you say, for example, go to, I don't know, Atlanta has got the Pinewood Studios there. They're doing all of the Marvel Comics films at the moment.
Pinewood Studios in London, aren't they?
Yeah, and London, but they're also in Atlanta as well. Right, right. They give a 30% tax deduction.
So you get a cheque for 30 mil?
30 mil back.
Wow.
And so Australia was basically out of the game. Hence Dora the Explorer. Dora came just before the government put in another incentive scheme for $144 million over 4 years.
Just for Dora?
Not for Dora, for all movies coming to Australia, and they could hand that money out to take the incentives up closer to those internationally. But Dora missed out. She got in just before that came in. And so Dora was going overseas until the Queensland government stepped in. And in something they've never talked about, the Queensland government tipped money into Dora to make certain that Dora was not made overseas, that it was made in the Gold Coast.
I don't know how Dora felt about that.
Now, Variety magazine in the States, because it's never been revealed here how much the Queensland government put in, but according to Variety magazine, they chipped in $8 million to make certain that Dora did not go and explore other horizons.
What do they have to do to get a James Bond movie here? Bond and Bondi.
Can you imagine that?
Hey!
Now we're going there, aren't we? Okay, so...
what would it take to get Bond here?
I don't think we'd get a Bond here.
Why?
Because I think apart from what the government tips in, it's what every other sponsor tips into the movie these days.
Yeah, but I mean, Bond's always at exotic locations. He's in Morocco or down the Amalfi Coast or on the Riviera or ploughing through London or
something.
Where
would you film it here?
On the Gold Coast. Get you 16 and a half. Huh?
That's exactly right. Plus extra money tipped in by... I wonder whether the state government's got enough money to do that, though.
See, in the new movie, he's got this new Aston Martin fancy pants thing. He's
Have you seen that?
What?
The Aston Martin Rapide E is that particular car.
What does the E stand for?
Electric.
Oh.
It's an electric car.
Like a Tesla?
Well, no. Excuse me. It's an Aston Martin Rapide E.
Okay.
And that's going to be the new Bond car. Do you remember one time they went off with BMWs because I took the cash for the BMWs?
I remember, I do. Beamer stumped
chipped
up
in, right? Like they stump up for everything. Because these days, part of the business of making movies is to make certain that you've got enough what they call product placement in the right places. And Bond is famous for this sort of stuff.
Yeah. It is. So Aston Martin wouldn't have only just provided the car, they'd also provided a bit of...
Hello, yes.
Really?
Part of their major, sort of, if you like,
underwriting the cost.
Underwriting the cost of the whole thing. So say, for example, if you go back to James Bond's favourite drink is...
Well, it's a martini. Vodka martini, shaken, not stirred.
Well,
hello.
Except if you go back to Skyfall, where it was a Heineken.
Why didn't he want vodka then? Vodka's...
$50
million. $50
million? I'll drink Heineken.
I'll have a Heine, please.
That's exactly right.
Make it nice and blizzardly cold.
So here's the interesting part about
$50 million.
$50 million.
To switch from your vodka martini to a
Heine. Shaken, not stirred, to a Heine. And that's what he did. Good, so the $50 million there was curious, Richard, because...
Much cheaper.
Much cheaper, that's right. Mm. Because the $50 million there was not only so that Bond would drink the Heineken in the movie, but also so that he would do a series of commercials for Heineken outside of the movie
billboards
as Bond.
And TV. And
the whole thing. The other thing also, we talked about electric cars earlier on and the Aston Martin Rapide E that will be in the James Bond film. Mm. Well, there's another electric vehicle that is also featured recently in another movie. Yeah. And that is Scarlett Johansson, who was in the Marvel film.
Yeah, she plays, what's her name? Black Widow.
Black Widow.
Yeah.
And she rides the brand new edition of the Harley Davidson.
Oh.
So this is called the Livewire.
Is it a Harley E?
Yes, it is. It's an E. It's the very first Harley Davidson electric motorbike.
Did we know that there were such things as electric motorbikes?
We do now.
We do now.
Because this particular motorbike, which will cost you somewhere between... 45 and 50,000 Aussie dollars to buy the motorbike.
Yowza.
When it arrives in Australia, but not until next year. So again, you've got to talk about the product placement because Harley's been trying to find a new niche apart from sort of aging blokes who have a change of life.
Well, Scarlett Johansson's a new niche.
She is. And the image of that whole Marvel Comics movie that she was in is of her on the motorbike hanging sideways.
The Avengers thing.
That's it. The Avengers thing.
So how much would they pay for that?
Well, the story was that they paid $10 million for that.
For the Harley.
The just one small thing about Bond 25.
Yes, sir.
What else do we know about this movie?
It's going to be very good.
Yes. Who's doing the song?
Well, we haven't heard it yet, but there are strong whispers that it could be a Beyoncé.
Really?
Also known as Beyoncé.
Is she an electric? Well, she's electric.
She's electric.
So you reckon Beyoncé will be doing this?
I think so, yeah. They're saying, one of my favourites was Skyfall.
Oh, Adele.
With Adele.
It's a Skyfall.
Oh, please, please.
I won't sing. No singing on this show.
No, but Beyoncé is rumoured to be doing. Sam Smith, of course, did the last one.
Do you know what they don't have in James Bond movies?
What?
Bands.
What do you mean bands?
Well, they don't have a band singing the song, do they? When did they last have a band singing the song?
I think that the name of the band that last sang a song in a James Bond movie would be Aha.
Seriously?
Aha.
Do you think if you get a Bond movie, because let's be honest, we've seen, say, Sam Smith do one.
Yeah, you're right. They're mainly individuals. Oh, is this you going to plug the Jonas Brothers, who are your new favourite?
I am. They're my new favourites.
Hmm.
How good are the Jonas Brothers?
They are pretty good.
Did you realise...
Joe was here last year doing The Voice.
Well, actually, let's pick up a little bit of Joe Jonas last year when he was here for The Voice.
Let's lose our minds, they go crazy, crazy.
How good is Joe Jonas?
Joe Jonas is great. We love Joe.
Right?
And the other boys.
Okay. So, the Jonas Brothers have got back together.
Mm.
They've put out a new single.
It's called Sucker.
I knew it was one of the S words.
It's not Scruncher.
Scruncher.
Sucker. It's Sucker.
Sucker. Sure, all right. It's called
Sucker.
It's
a great song. It's a huge hit.
Great song. Huge hit.
Mm.
Huge hit. Okay. So, here's the interesting thing about this. They are the first band to have a debut number one single.
Number one what? Single.
Single on the Billboard Top 100 charts since the 1990s.
That cannot be true.
It is true.
What about Bon Jovi?
Bon Jovi never debuted, and besides, he would be older than that.
What about NSYNC?
No.
What about One Direction?
No, they didn't.
What do you mean they didn't? Albums all went to number one.
They did not debut at number one.
What, the albums did? I'm sure.
There are only 34 acts that have debuted at number one, and the Jonas Brothers are a band, and they are the first band to do it for more than 25 years.
What about Santana with Smooth?
Okay, you might have me there. He might be the last one.
Goodness me.
Is he a band or a person?
Carlos Santana has a band called Santana.
Guess what? I think we're going to
Named after himself.
Don't you think?
Yes. Today's show was brought to you by the letter E.